All praise to the Most High God of Israel. My name is VCE Smith, and I am the rib of the watchman. And I want to thank you for tuning in this evening on our midweek teaching to hear a word from the Holy Father of Israel. He has something for you. He always has something for you. It's a blessing to be allowed in your homes. For you to hear what thus saith the Lord. And tonight, we're going to break down some of the lies of Mr. Lucifer and his church. You know, I don't even know how to word it. First, I was feeling sorry for those that cannot receive this and cannot accept this truth. And are going to stand strong and firm on the lies of Lucifer and his son, a.k.a. Jesus, or either him, a.k.a. Jesus. They refuse. They just refuse. So now I'm going to be as bold as they are. I don't care. I don't care what happens to you. I don't care anymore. Because if you're going to be that defiant with me, you're going to be the same way with Elijah when he comes. Because what God has given us is, right now is a preparatorial, as you would say. This is a pre-teaching of understanding and knowledge to know that everything that you ever thought was true was a lie, is a lie. And it's plain. I mean, I'm going to be honest with you. If I was on the other side of the camera and I was listening, I would fully understand what's being said, even though it wasn't told to me by the Most High God. It was told to me through someone he's using. I would still see this thing. How can anything be wrong? How can anything not line up? I can't listen. Even on your job, especially if you work in assembly line, if y'all need all work with the same parts, and you will all see from the start of this thing to the ending of this thing, whatever you're making or creating, if you're building a car, you can't start at the beginning of the car and then in the middle of the car completely change the design of the car. It will not work. When you get down to the finish line, the car won't jive. The car won't come together. Nobody's going to believe that this car is a working car that's worth me investing money in and time and labor when it doesn't even jive together. It doesn't even fit. So we're breaking this word down to you, Israel, so that you can see these things don't jive. It does not go together. It has to match. If I say that my mother and her eldest siblings or the elder siblings of my mother were born in Alabama and the younger ones were born in another state, it has to line up. I have to be able to know some kind of way that she was born in Alabama. But if you come, let's say the state is Kentucky, and they all live in Kentucky, and you say, oh, all of them were born in Kentucky, that won't jive, because the elder ones were born in Alabama, not Kentucky. So you can't get to the middle of the story and now change it and say something different. So tonight, we're going to look at how the words are twisted is the reason why when you read it, you think it's saying something else. All right, we're going to get started, class. Let's go here to Acts chapter 6. And I can basically break this story down to you. This story is about the priest hearing the things that Lucifer, a.k.a. Jesus, has been out saying that he was going to do, that they knew that whoever these people are, and I'll set the story up for you. Abraham had many children. Abraham did not just have Jacob and his sons. Abraham also had children by his concubines and different women. And Haggai had two sons. Haggai had Ishmael, the firstborn of all, but Ishmael is not counted as Haggai's son. Ishmael is counted as Sarah's son. And it says so in the Living Word that Ishmael is Sarah's son. And then Haggai had another child, and they were put out of the camp because when the boy and Isaac were weaned off the bottle together, meaning they were no longer on the nipple, this kid was mocking and making fun of Isaac. Okay? So we know there are many other children that can claim to be Abraham's seed. They're all Abraham's seed. Abraham is the father of many nations, not no white ones, because he wasn't white. He can't produce any white children. He never did produce white children. But all these dark people over there in the land, a bunch of them were the children of Abraham. And they claimed to be the children of Abraham because they were. They were just not Jacob's sons, and the lineage of the Hebrew Israelites are the chosen. So when you get into these books and you're reading these books in the New Testament, you got to know some of the history, because you don't go back. You don't know what you're even reading, because you never went back to figure these things out. And they weren't told to you. They weren't broke down to you. But God's going to break some of these things down. And you go back and you find out, well, Abraham was also married after Sarah died and they had sons. So all these are Abraham's children. And when you get into the New Testament and you hear these statements made, they practiced the same lifestyle as the Hebrew Israelites did, because everybody heard how the Hebrew Israelites lived and the laws that they were governed by. And everybody was governed by those laws. When they would come in, and those that God allowed to come in and hear what was said around the congregation in the temple, then they would come out, and those that were allowed in to hear heard it. So then they took it out and they shared it with people, and they told people, and it went on and on and on. So when you read these things in the New Testament, you have to understand how to break them down. So we're in chapter 6, and we're going to start with this story. This story is about the prophets, the priest, rather, hearing the blasphemous things that Jesus is saying against Moses and God. Because he spoke blasphemous things against them. The whole book is a blasphemy book. So let's go ahead, and I'm not gonna be able to read it all for time's sake. I had to work over today. I'm running behind, so the video's gonna. You do know you're receiving it a little bit late tonight, but servitude calls. So what we're gonna start with here in this chapter, I'm gonna read the entire chapter. You're gonna read that bull crap in the middle, because it's necessary, but it's not necessary for the way that the Father broke it down to me. All right, so. It says, and in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied. Now, these are the people that followed Jesus. It could be any random person. He didn't care about what they were, who they were, where they came from, what they looked like. None of that mattered to him. He'd take anything. So his disciples were multiplying, not God's. It doesn't say that the disciples of God are the followers of the Lord, or God himself, the Almighty, the Most High. People were starting to follow him. Doesn't say that. There arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews. Now look at that cute little thing there. The Hebrews. You don't hear that very much. And then a question I would ask, why come it doesn't say against the Jews? But anyway, because he wants to make you have association and familiarity with Israel. So he says Hebrews. So apparently, you're going to find out about some things that are taking place and what brought this on. It says, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Now, whatever was taking place in this temple, where these people are supposed to be Hebrews, which they're not, but they're saying for this story in chapter 6 to be associated with the Old Testament, these women of these disciples, whom nobody knew, nobody knows anything about these people, wanted to come up to this temple that these so-called Hebrews were working in, doing things for God, which I don't know what Hebrews would be doing things for God, but it should say Levites. huh? Or should say Israel, but he says Hebrews. So they wanted to come up and participate. Well, they said, hell no. What y'all doing up here? Anyway, let's go to verse 2. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples. Now, stop right there. Then the 12. The 12 who? They don't make that clear. But I'm going to tell you who the 12 are. It's the 12 so-called disciples of Lucifer. He called the multitude of disciples. Because remember, of the disciples, they was multiplying. They were starting to multiply, which makes no sense. Because wherever they are, whatever is transpiring, these people are now growing. So we're all going to assume they're in a crowd of people. All right? Called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God to serve tables. So they was asking, whoa, hold your horses, you Hebrews, or the ones that are supposed to be Hebrews. Well, who do you think you are to tell us that we can't work in here? We're just random strange people that just start believing this stuff, and we may not have any bloodline or any connection to anything, but we chose to listen to these men and we want to work in this temple. And why can't our wives work in here? Why can't us, our widows, come in here in the temple? What widows ever worked in the temple or the church or whatever you got in here going on? What kind of mess is this? So it's all this mumbo jumbo going on in this teaching that you got to try to look through this thing and break it down. So they're asking. Verse 3. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report. Now, first of all, you just started multiplying. You didn't know these people. So you've got the 12 looking out in the midst of all these people, the drunks and the whores and the prostitutes and the murderer and the rapist and, you know, all those that can come. And he said, find seven. Huh? Look out in that crowd. And among you, a seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom. How do they know anybody? How would they know what they were full of? How would they know if they even had any intelligence? They just started multiplying. Whom we may appoint over this business. So, in other words, look out in that crowd and see who we can gather that just came on board now, don't really know what's going on, but they just came on board and they're going to be able to handle this business that we got dealing with these so-called Hebrews telling us we can't do nothing up in here. Now, does that make any sense? Well, let's keep on going. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Now you just jump from one thing to another thing. So what they gonna do is look out in the crowd, all the vagabonds and all the junk that's out there that say they believe, and pick seven people, and we're gonna be in continually prayer. Verse 5. And the same pleased the whole multitude. What? And they chose Stephen. Hot dog. Looked out in the crowd and I guess Stephen didn't look to be as drunk as all the rest of them. Or didn't look, maybe he had a bath, or I don't know what they saw on him, but they chose Stephen. A man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. How? How did they know that? They just chose Stephen. He told them to randomly look out and pick. Now look at all these fools. All these names. Not one of them's a Hebrew name. I can't pronounce these stupid ass names. Not one of them's a Hebrew name. Not one of them is from tribe of any of the 12. And then he ends off of Antioch. Now y'all pronounce them stupid foolish ass names. Let's go down here to verse 6. Whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. So they done all this praying. He done all this picking and choosing. Now they done prayed and turn around and they lay their hands on them. Verse 7. And the word of God increased How did the word of God increase when they never said the word of God? The whole time they were making all the decisions. Did not they say, they picked, they did, they... But now the word of God increased. And the number of disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. See, now that this thing is being broke down to you, you see the foolishness of it. And a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. And Stephen, verse 8, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Hold it right fucking there. Ain't a goddamn soul in this Bible didn't a wonder or a miracle but the living God. You mean to tell me some straight up piece of fuck they found in the midst of a crowd randomly start doing things that God did, and the bitch couldn't even stop him from stoning his ass to death? You believe that? Some random freak that was chosen by other random freaks just obliviously out of the blue started being God. Do you know what a miracle is? A miracle is when water parts the sea, opens up, and thousands of people, millions, walk through on dry land. When a rock, a wonder follows you in the desert, out in the wilderness, and giving you water to drink, and you would accept this bullshit crap word written and says that this man became God. Because that is exactly what they're saying. No one can perform a miracle or a wonder but the living God. I hate this word. I hate this shit they have written. Let's finish it. That's what Stephen did among the people. Verse 9. Then there arose certain of the synagogue. Now check this out. Which is called the synagogue of the Libertines and the Syrians or whoever. And Alexanders and of them of Cilicia and Azazel. Keep on going. They rose up with Stephen. Certain ones of these people. All these non-Hebrew people. All these non-Hebrew names. All these names that don't make any sense and have no connection to anything. They arose up with Stephen. Verse 10. And they were not able to resist the wisdom of the Spirit by which he spoke. Oh, it was fighting with it. Oh, I can't do this. It's so powerful. Ooh, you know how the Christians be in there with they cooking all and they be laying hands. They be touching and laying. They couldn't resist it. It overtook them. It was so powerful what he said. Verse 11. Then they suborned men. Now check this out. These other men couldn't resist it. They just were so all into it. But they were of no value. Because check this out. It says, then they went. No, it says in verse 11. Let me pull my computer up. Because I got to get this for y'all to get some understanding of these words. Because y'all read this stuff and don't understand what the words mean. Then they suborned men. So let's go here and let's read with that the definition and let's get the meaning of this word, because see, y'all thought that meant they just took them probably and they gathered them together. Listen, this is what they did. They got these men. This is what they did. This word means to bridle or induce someone unlawfully or secretly to perform some misdeed or to commit a crime to break the law. So that's what Mr. Stephen did. Listen to what he said now. Which said, these criminals, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. Now, hold on. They was trying to find people who would say, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes and came upon him and caught him and brought him to the council and set up false witnesses. Now check this out. They are saying that they found some people to say these things. But check this out, how the wording goes and how the wording gets twisted. And set up false witnesses, which said, this man ceases not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law. So in other words, they were saying, the priests and the prophets, they lied on them. They were saying that they were speaking these things against Moses and God. But they found people to be false witnesses and say, this man ceases not to speak blasphemous words against the holy place. And he did. He spoke blasphemous words and he said things against the living God and Moses that were not true. And we're going to keep on reading and you're going to see just how he lies. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place. You know he said it. You know they heard him say it. Huh? And shall change the customs which Moses delivered us. Huh? They went out and got liars to say that this is not a truth. It was the truth. I told you up there earlier. They went and found some people. They lied. He was saying those things. He said the temple would be torn. The curtain's gonna be rent. And all that, I'll build it up in 3 days. He was a blasphemous liar. Okay, 14. For we have heard him say that Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us. And all that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel. Well, excuse me. You got all these folk. They didn't know nothing about God. They didn't know nothing about none of this stuff. They was just hearing something said in this court, in this temple area. And now they know what angels look like. Do you see what we're talking about? Do you see how this word is written? Do you see how this makes it angelical? This makes it, you have never seen an angel. No one that you know that has ever lived, that you know, has ever seen an angel. But these people now are looking upon Stephen as if he saw the face of an angel, and all the other men, they're so scared. Bullshit. Every drop of it. Let's go to chapter 7. Then said the high priest, which I don't know whose high priest it is, but you know, they throw a high priest in there. Are these things so? So the high priest was saying, wait, whoa, whoa, whoa. You mean to tell me this Jesus of Nazareth was going around talking about he's going to destroy this temple that we work in, that we serve the high God, the most high? Is it so? Verse 2. And he said, men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham. Now, when they say this, these people could be telling the truth. Even though when we get down here in the story, it's going to be some places and things thrown in here that don't go with the story, because a lot of this shit's just made up. But this is the truth. They're asking a question, because these people, even though they're not of the 12 tribes, they're not Hebrew Israelites, they are children of Abraham, and they knew the laws that was passed down from Abraham. Because they knew Abraham had the law. They knew these laws that God had given. Abraham lived by them. So they're saying, they're asking this question. Could this be true? Y'all know, brother and fathers, men of all y'all, of Abraham. But listen to this. When he was in Mesopotamia, I believe that's how that goes, before he dwelt in Sharam, which there's no such place. I want y'all to go back to your Old Testament, get your concordance out, or ask your Bible Gateway or anybody to find this place. Your ancestor Abraham never lived there. So again, we taught y'all how they use names of familiarity to try to make these stories line up with our stories. There's no such place. Our father Abraham never lived there, never dwelt there. Okay, let's see. Let's go to Genesis 24. Let's look at Genesis 24. Genesis 24 is about the story of Mesopotamia, or wherever this place is where our father Abraham was. And when he dwelt there in this land, he told his hand, high hand, which is the one that served him and was over all his things, to take his son out of that country, because he could not marry a woman from there, and take him to his uncle and let him get a wife in their country. So let's see, let's look at this. I'm on fine here. Let's look at four. But thou shalt go into my country and to my kindred and take a wife unto my son Isaac. And y'all read the top if you want to. The servant said unto him, peradventure the woman will not be willing to follow me unto this land. Must I needs bring thy son again unto the land from whence thou camest? And Abraham said unto him, beware thou that thou bring my son, not my son, hither again. Meaning, don't bring him back here. Don't bring him back here to this place, because in this place is not where our people dwell. It's not. I'm only here. I'm here. Now, let's keep on going down. All right, in seven, it says, the Lord God of heaven, which took me from my father's house and from the land of my kindred, and which spake unto me, and that swear unto me, saying, unto thy seed will I give this land. He shall send his angel before thee, and thou shalt take a wife unto my son from thence. And if the woman will not be willing to follow thee, then thou shalt be clear from this my oath. I mean, he took an oath with Abraham, okay, to do this for him concerning his son Isaac. Alright. Vicky, you went too far. Hold on, y'all. Let me get back here where he took the oath. Okay. Follow me. Alright. Declare the oath. Verse 8. Only bring not my son hither again, the servants of his hand, under thy Abraham master. Okay, all right, let's do verse 10. And the servant took 10 camels of the camels of his master and departed. For all the goods of his master were in his hand, and he arose, and he went to Mesopotamia, unto the city of Nahor. Wait a minute, whoa, did I say that right? He went? I thought Abraham was in Mesopotamia and then dwelt in wherever that hell that place is. The servant went to get Isaac a wife there. Huh? In the city of Nahor. He's a liar. See, God is breaking these down, all these scriptures down, all these verses down, so that you can see. He doesn't have to prove this to you, because all you now that are the children of God and those that are seeing this, you already know now. Y'all see, y'all don't even want to read the New Testament because you know it's just a crock of bullshit. But for those that come to you, because they're going to come to you and tell you these things and use these scriptures, God is showing you how Lucifer has lied all through this whole word. None of it's true. Not even they couldn't even get the places right, y'all. Come on. Verse 3. And said unto him, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred, and come unto the land which I shall show thee. Then came he out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Charran. There's no such place on the face of the earth. This place did not exist in the old time. This is not a place that your father Abraham went to. So now again, we know they're talking about some different people. They are not talking about the family of the Hebrew Israelites. All right, let's go. Let's see. When his father was dead, he moved him into this land wherein ye now dwell. What a lie. Huh? We're back to Acts. We're back to chapter 7. Going over the lie that he told on your father, Abraham. Which could be his father, Abraham. We don't know who this man is. We don't know who they're talking about. Now, he's telling the story. This priest is trying to tell the story about Abraham. Now, he's talking about his father, Abraham. Which this could be, like I said, this could be someone who believed that they're the seed of Abraham. They knew back then. They knew whether or not they was one of his offspring. Okay? Now, let's go ahead and see what else he says here. It says, verse 5, and he gave him none inheritance in it. No, not so much as he set his foot on. Yet he promised that he would give it to him for a possession and to his seed after him when as yet he had no child. He never promised that to Abraham. He had a child. He had Isaac. He had Ishmael. He had the boy. He had all these other children by the concubines. What are they talking about? And see, that's the questions y'all gonna have to start asking yourselves when you read this stuff. Go back. When you see somebody's name, go back and see if you can find it in the Old Testament. When you see one of these cities or towns, go back and see if you can find it in the Old Testament. It's not there. So then you know. They are not lying. They're telling the truth. This stuff is all made up. Verse 6. And God spake on this wise. So now they're saying, this is the priest, he's saying, and God spake on this wise, that his seed should sojourney in a strange land, and that they should bring them into bondage and entreat them evil for 400 years. Now, stop. Y'all know that when Isaac went down to Mesopotamia, he went to get a wife. And he served his uncle Laban, I think, or Naban, or whatever his name is, for his wife. He wanted Rachel. He served the first 7 years, thought he was going to get her, and he got the other sister. Then he served 7 more years, and he wound up getting Rachel. Well, he was given... servants and somebody else in there too, concubines and all kind of stuff. But y'all see that this whole story is a lie. They did not go down to this place. They did not become in bondage for 400 years. He served his uncle when Isaac got there, and he saw Rachel at the well, and life went as his father Abraham wanted it to go, and he found his bride there. This New Testament is a crock of shit. Why do y'all think God brings you his word and tells you to compare it to Lucifer's word? But y'all are going to still refuse to accept God's truths. Listen. Plain and simple. Simple things like looking into whatever he says about Abraham. Simple. Looking into whatever he says about Isaac. Simple. When he uses words like Hebrew, he would never say the Hebrew Israelites and such. Because he's not talking about your ancestors. He's speaking of other people. For some reason, God wanted me to tell y'all this. For some reason, this was important because there are so many people who use this New Testament to prove Jesus. in the Old Testament. Well, if you can't get the people that are from the Old Testament right, how you gonna get Jesus right? Who is this Abraham that he's speaking of? Who are these priests? Who are these so-called Hebrews? It could have been what tribe? The Hebrews are 12 different nations, 12 different peoples. What are you talking about? All from the same man and what, four different women? But there weren't four different rainbows of color. It wasn't four different types of people. It was four women. These all were the same women. Isaac couldn't have a woman unless it was of his family. Even the concubines. Do y'all not know that in Israel, even from the tribe of Levi, the workers, the concubines of different men were family members. They just were not of high ranking as children. They were Levites, and they worked. So even when Isaac, you go back and read that story about Isaac and him wanting Rachel, and then Rachel gave the concubine that worked for her was a family member. It could have been a third or fourth cousin. But these are all the same people. And y'all get so confused. Unless your mama stepped out on your daddy, or your daddy stepped out on your mama, or y'all come from a house where mama has several men, and or whatever. If two people get together of the same nation and the same nationality, and they produce a child, it don't matter how many they produce. If she went and her sister, the father and the mother of the sisters are the same. So if he's producing with two sisters, what's he going to get? He's going to get the same. Just by two different women. They're not two different nations. They're the same nation. So with these concubines that Rachel gave her husband, that all these children, one of them, what was her name? I can't even think of it. Gave him six children. So they were of the same family. So one's not going to look like a Chinese. One's not going to be a Caucasian. One's not going to be an Arab. One's going to be just like all of them. They're going to all look the same. These people all look the same, y'all. I'm sorry. I know that's offensive to you. I know that hurts you. I know that, oh God. Listen. The Father is waking you up because the time is drawing nigh. Elijah is on his way. No matter how long it seems or how long it takes, he's still on his way. He's trying to get these people who are hanging by a thread, still holding on to this Jesus belief. Because they still, I know it, there's billions, because they keep coming to the website and calling them us false prophets and liars and deceivers. And don't listen to them. They're leading you astray. If they would only listen to the video, they may see something. We give you golden nuggets to go back and check your... This is... They talk about research. Hell, you got enough to research right in the Bible by itself. Go. Compare these names. Compare these places. There should be no doubt in your mind. But for those of you that want to continue on and want to believe this lie, all I can say is, you're going to die. I mean, I got some people I love dearly. Got some people that look just like me. When I say just like me from head to toe, I look just like them because most of them are older. These people are not going to let go of Lucifer. They got this club thing, and it's kind of like, well, if my great-grandmother and my great-great-grandmother and my grandmother and my mother and me and all of our kids... If this ain't true, I'd rather go to hell with my family. Not go to hell, but be destroyed with my family. I'm not going to believe that. Jesus said for me to not hear nothing nobody else said. Well, my thing is this. If Lucifer said a stranger's voice you will not hear or listen to or understand, how do you hear us? Y'all know the verses in there. So tonight, class, I hope that you take this lesson and dig through that book and look at those names, places, and people and see if you can find anything that's even close to it in the Old Testament. They don't even be close. In the Old Testament, I mean. Take them New Testament words and see if you can find them. We hope tonight that you will do that, and that this can help you explain to maybe some of your family members that are so stuck on believing that these everything Jesus said was the truth. He never lied. None of the disciples ever lied. The disciples, who are these people? Who are they? Even if he had gotten 12 disciples, couldn't those disciples have at least been one from every tribe of Israel to even play it off? I mean, he could even name them people from the tribes of Israel to be a play off, but this man went all the way off the charts to prove to you this ain't them people. So we thank the Most High God, family. You know, we're really putting forth all we can, because listen, the Father, when he brings this stuff, he is so serious. He really in his heart loves you. He doesn't want to destroy you, but this is his order about doing things. You have to hear his word. You have to understand it, because here he brings peons, little nothings like us, to bring it to you. Do you think that when somebody comes here from another place and starts coming against your Lucifer, because you've been told the Antichrist is going to come, hell to the fuck, the God of Antichrist is coming. His name is Yah. Huh? You're right. And so is Elijah. He's Antichrist. Do you know anti means against? Not far. So you already prepared to die, and you're going to die. This is all we can do. We cry out and we cry out and we cry out. So family, we thank you for tuning in tonight. We hope you come for the Sabbath teachment. I know the watchman will either have a conclusion, I believe, for you on your last Sabbath teaching. We want to thank the Most High God for his revealing of the word. And we tell you tonight, Shalom.